Hi, everyone. Please give a very, very warm welcome to Patrick and to Alejandro. A very warm welcome. And also to Claudia. A very warm welcome to Claudia. So I think before we start, I think we should all give another very big round of applause to Ngugi and to Lem for this amazing, 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 amazing conversation. It's my immense pleasure to be in conversation here with Patrick Chamazo and with Alejandro Zambra, who are two of the protagonists of the Studio Creole, and of course also with Claudia Bragmann, who is a protagonist translating actually the work of Patrick. As already in the introduction Adam said, we are so delighted actually to discuss with Patrick about creolization, very much also about the title of the exhibition. Patrick was born in Fort de France, in Martinique. He's a novelist, essayist, a scriptwriter, and like Edouard Glissant, also a public intellectual. We'll hear from him about the story he wrote for Studio Creole. Alejandro Zambra is the author of Bonsai, The Private Lives of Trees, as well as also Ways of Going Home, My Documents, Multiple Joys, and many more books, and is now based in Mexico City. I wanted to begin with Patrick and actually ask you, because we met for the very first time in the apartment of Edouard Glissant in Paris. It was at the time when you were writing a kind of a manifesto related to Obama. And I just wanted to ask you to tell us a little bit about your relationship to Glissant and you know, the inspiration you took from him.
Oui, merci Hans. J'ai rencontré Edouard Glissant.
Yes, thank you. I met Edouard Glissant
très tôt.
Very, very early.
Tout au début de ma
right at the beginning,
du commencement de mon écriture.
When I started
c'est quand
writing.
J'ai commencé à écrire que j'ai
writing,
fait la démarche d'aller le trouver pour lui demander de me faire une préface à mon premier roman. Mais avant d'écrire, j'avais commencé
writing,
à lire ses romans
I'd
et à lire ses essais
his novels and his essays.
Et à comprendre qu'on avait là non
and
seulement l'esthétique littéraire
we not only shared the same literary aesthetics
mais
that was very
avait
powerful,
véritablement
but
une pensée
really
du monde,
du monde world,
actuel
of the world currently
qui nous était nécessaire pour bien vivre
and we felt that it was
toutes les accélérations
to
et toutes les mutations
well all the
que nous devons affronter aujourd'hui. J'ai eu une grande chance.
So I was really
considère
very
que c'est une
lucky.
Chance d'avoir pu
I think
rencontrer
it was a great opportunity
un poète de cette envergure.
A poet
alors, ce qui est important,
caliber.
C'est que
Glissant,
on aurait pu dire
with Glissant,
c'est un romancier, c'est un essayiste,
we can call him a novelist,
c'est un anthropologue, c'est un sociologue.
We can call him many sociologist,
il y a beaucoup d'étiquettes
et cetera,
qu'on aurait pu lui donner.
He bears many labels.
Mais l'étiquette qu'il préférait, c'était
label
celle de poète.
Preferred was that of a poet.
Et il disait que face à la situation du monde contemporain,
when faced with,
face à la complexité du monde
today,
contemporain, ce qu'il nous fallait, ce n'était pas
what
un système de pensée,
thinking,
c'est-à-dire une explication globale et définitive
global and definitive
de ce que nous vivons,
of what we are living,
mais qu'il nous fallait une poétique.
But rather we needed poetry.
Et la poétique est importante
poetics are important
dans la mesure où la poétique elle peut nous préserver des pensées de
système
et des systèmes de pensée.
Ways of thinking about systems as well as systems of reflection.
C'est-à-dire la tendance que l'on pourrait
that
avoir
to say,
à donner une explication définitive
aux choses
et à décrire de manière définitive le monde
dans
lequel nous vivons. Il y a une telle complexité du monde
the world is so complex
que nous ne pouvons pas aujourd'hui essayer de l'envisager sans une poétique.
Contemplate it without poetics.
Et cette complexité du monde, il l'appelle le tout-monde. C'est-à-dire qu'il considérait que le monde aujourd'hui
which
était
means
fait
that he believed today's world is made up of encounters between civilizations, cultures, and individuals.
Que le monde était devenu un
and
chaos
that the
relationnel,
world had become a chaos of relationships.
Et que ce chaos relationnel
this
était absolument inconnaissable,
was impossible to know and fully unpredictable. Et c'est dans cette inconnaissable,
it is within these unpredictable encounters that we now need to live, create, believe, exist.
Et cet imprévisible, enfin, ce
this
chaos,
unpredictable thing, this chaos,
la relation.
Is something that he would call the relationship.
Et l'idée de relation, ça change
this
tout.
Idea of relationship changes
dans la mesure
everything.
Où nous étions habitués
as
à vivre
we are used
avec
to
des absolutes,
living with absolutes.
Ma langue, ma
our
peau,
language,
mon
our
territoire,
skin, our territory,
mes dieux,
our
mes
gods,
ancêtres,
our ancestors, and so on and so forth.
Alors qu'aujourd'hui, du fait de la relation,
but today, when we think about the relationship,
tous les enfants, la plupart des enfants
all children, most children who are born in
se
this world,
entre plusieurs
find themselves located between various territories, histories, languages, and memories.
Et on est passé d'une identité
we've moved on from one identity with a unique vertical
à une identité
root
relationnelle
to an identity that's
de la capacité
based on relationships, and it's built on our
la
capacity to
la
have a relationship
monde
with the world's diversity.
Alors quand on me dit studio créole,
so when I hear the word studio creole,
je vois un laboratoire, un petit laboratoire du monde.
The small laboratory of the world.
Et c'est exactement dans ce studio.
And it's really right in that studio that you see what you might call the situation of the contemporary writer.
Auparavant,
before,
l'écrivain était
the writer
en face d'un absolu linguistique.
Was faced with a linguistic absolute.
Ils pensaient qu'avec sa langue,
they believed that
sa seule langue,
through their one single language,
ils étaient en mesure d'épuiser la totalité du réel et d'une certaine manière de comprendre le monde.
Reality in a certain way of understanding the world.
Et aujourd'hui,
but today,
quel que soit l'écrivain, quel que soit l'endroit où il se trouve,
the writer, wherever they are,
lorsqu'il écrit,
when they write,
il écrit en présence de toutes les
they
langues du monde.
Write in the presence of all languages
toutes
of the world.
D'une manière ou d'une autre,
all languages in one way or another echo into their ear.
Et ça, ça change tout.
And this
dans
changes
le rapport que
l'on everything based on our relationship with language.
Et Glissant disait, lorsque
and
j'écris,
Glissant would say that when I write,
j'écris non pas avec un absolu
I write not within a linguistic absolute,
mais j'écris avec le désir imaginant
but with
de toutes
this
les langues
desire to access all languages of the world.
Ça fait un langage très particulier.
This creates a very particular language.
Alors, dans le studio créole, c'est
in Studio Creole,
parce que
what is extraordinary
on entend presque
is that we hear almost all languages of the world.
On entend les traductions.
We hear the interpretations.
Parce que dans la relation, le traducteur
because
devient
within
important.
The relationship, the interpreters are important.
Et on a une incarnation
and there's a form
théâtrale
theatrical incarnation of what's being expressed
donc
by
là,
the writer.
On a véritablement un concentré
and so there you have a true concentrate of contemporary reality and contemporary aesthetics.
Now, I wanted to ask you to tell us a little bit more about the idea of creolization, because we quoted Glissant initially from a quote he told me in one of my many interviews. I've spoken to Glissant probably 50 times, and in one of these interviews he said that the American archipelagos are extremely important because it's in these islands that the idea of creolization, that the blend of cultures was most brilliantly fulfilled. Now you have been so involved with this idea of creolization. You have been part and protagonist, of course, of the Creolité movement. You have co-authored with Raphaël Confiant and Jean Bernabé an éloge de la créolité. So I wanted to ask you to tell us a little bit about that, about your relationship to that notion, which I think has been changing a lot over time. It's shifting. It's en mouvement.
Oui, c'est très très très
yes,
difficile.
Yes, it's very difficult.
Ce qu'il faut comprendre, c'est
what
que Glissant dans les années 50,
in the 1950s,
au moment où on est confronté aux décolonisations,
at that time where one was faced with decolonization, so the wars of independence were exploding all over Africa.
Glissant va tirer
at this
une
time,
leçon
Glissant
learned
a different lesson from colonization.
Tout en se battant contre les colonialistes,
fighting against colonialists.
Il va dire que le plus important,
and he went on to say that the most important thing which produced during the time of colonization,
c'est que les cultures, les civilisations,
the cultures and civilization,
les langues, les dieux,
languages and gods, phénotypes,
sont rentrés dans un processus
then entered de mise into en a process where they became related to one another.
Et que ce sont désormais ces flux relationnels
from then on, it was qui vont déterminer these types of relationships and their flows that determined the most important things that we were going to experience in the future.
Alors comment ça ça a commencé?
Now how did this all begin? He went on to say, as he was born in the Caribbean,
lorsqu'il regarde la situation
that
des
when
Caraïbes,
he examined the situation there in the Caraïbes,
il va dire que la Caraïbe est née,
he said that the Caribbean was born from an encounter or an impact between Amerindian civilizations,
les civilisations africaines,
African civilizations,
les civilisations ou la civilisation occidentale,
Western civilizations or the Western civilization,
and
all the immigrations that would occur from then on.
Alors toutes les cultures et les civilisations,
then all cultures and civilizations always represented moments of encounters.
Mais dans la Caraïbe, ce
but
qui s'est produit,
in the Caribbean, what happened?
C'est que les civilisations, les cultures et les individus se sont fracassés de manière massive et accélérée.
Became fragmented in a very accelerated, massive way.
Et cette rencontre massive et accélérée,
this mass encounter
des peuples,
became
des cultures
accelerated and it impacted peoples, civilizations and tribes.
Lissant va l'appeler la relation,
and
dans
Lissant
la créolisation.
Called this creolization.
Donc il y a créolisation.
So we have creolization.
Lorsque dans un espace donné,
when in one given space,
on a plusieurs imaginaires,
you have
plusieurs
several
langues,
imaginaries,
plusieurs
several languages, several concepts of the world that meet to produce something new.
Ce qui fait que dans le processus
what
de
this means is that within the creolization process,
qui sont des créolités.
Well, things emerge and we call them creolities.
Alors pour comprendre. Quand vous regardez l'archipel
if you look at the archipelago of the Caribbean,
vous pouvez dire que cette civilisation des Caraïbes
you can say that this Caribbean civilization is a creolization space.
Et que dans cette créolisation
but within this Caribbean creolization,
on a les créolités singulières,
you have singular creolities, that is to say Martinique, Guadeloupe, Cuba, and so on and so forth.
Une partie des États-Unis,
part of the United States as well.
Donc on a un processus de créolisation.
There is then a process of creolization that produces creolities.
Mais l'essence même du processus, c'est la relation.
But the very essence of the process is the relationship.
Et Glissant disait que le plus grand objet de littérature,
would say that the greatest objective in literature today,
c'est d'apprendre nos imaginaires,
is to learn our imaginary and our identities.
À se penser et à se vivre,
to learn our reflection and our ways of living,
à l'échelle de la totalité monde,
on the full world scale,
totalité monde où toutes
the totality
les diversités
of the world where all diversities
sont en relation,
relate to one another.
Alors ça change tout.
And that changes everything.
Now before we talk to Alejandro about his story, I wanted to have a last question to you. About the story, actually, for Studio Creole, the story which you all have also in the book, and that's actually connected to the novel Sartorius from 1999, a book by Edouard Glissant. It's my favorite novel of Glissant, and he describes in this book the utopian Batutu people that derive its identity not from its own genealogy, but solely from being in constant exchange with others. Glissant also connected this actually to utopia, because he told me that it's a quivering, no? It's a trembling. He talked about l'utopie du tremblement. He talked about the trembling utopia, which transcends established systems of thought and subjects itself to the unknown. So I wanted to ask you why you chose for Studio Creole this amazing story of these Batutu people from Sartorius.
Oui.
Yes.
Ce que je raconte dans le texte
what
que j'ai lu, c'est ce qu'aurait pu dire un personnage qui s'appelle un Batuto.
That we call a Batuto could have said.
Le Batuto, c'est le membre d'un peuple qui a été inventé par
Edouard Glissant.
Alors Glissant considérait
que
dans le monde contemporain,
in today's world,
quel que soit l'individu,
whoever the individual,
il est obligé d'organiser lui-même
they
themselves
son architecture de
principes
et de valeurs,
their own architecture of principles and values,
à l'échelle non pas
on a scale
d'un territoire,
that is not
d'une langue,
the scale
Dieu,
of a territory, a language, a god, or an enclosure,
mais en face de tous les territoires,
but rather all territories,
langues,
all
les
languages,
les
all gods, all human existences.
Chaque individu
every individual
est précipité sur la grande scène du monde.
Exists on the great stage of the world.
Et cette idée de relation,
this idea of a relationship,
change complètement la perception que nous pouvons avoir de notre identité,
identity,
de notre rapport aux langues,
of our relationship with languages,
ou de du rapport qu'on peut avoir au territoire,
or the relationship that we might have with territories.
Et il y a une nouvelle complexité
qui
provient de la relation
that comes from the relationship,
et qui peut permettre de comprendre,
which allows us to understand,
je peux écrire en français,
that, for example, I can write in French,
sans appartenir à la littérature
without
française,
belonging necessarily to French literature.
Et que ce n'est pas la langue qui crée la fraternité
language
littéraire.
Does not create literary fraternity.
Ce qui crée la fraternité littéraire,
what creates literary fraternity,
ce sont les structures d'imaginaire.
The imaginary structures.
C'est-à-dire que what c'est le rapport que l'on a à la diversité du monde.
It's the relationship that we have with the world's diversity.
Qui va désigner les frères.
That then goes to designate our brothers.
Je peux avoir la peau noire.
I might be black.
Mais je suis plus proche
but I am
de n'importe quel écrivain
closer to any
de
other
de Caraïbe,
white Caribbean writer
que d'un écrivain africain.
Than I might be an African writer.
Même si j'ai des solidarités
even
évidentes
though I
avec
feel
l'Afrique,
a sense of solidarity clearly with Africa and all African languages.
Donc les structures d'imaginaire sont
so
importantes
the structures of our imagination are important because they are forged in relation to the world's diversity.
Et chaque individu
and each individual
face à cette
builds themselves in the within the framework of this diversity.
Vous verrez très souvent
and that's why often today you will see that writers can travel between languages.
L'écrivain peut commencer à écrire,
a writer may start writing. Kundera wrote in Czech.
Il écrit en français.
Now he writes
on a
in French.
There are
many examples of writers who've traveled between languages.
Donc ils changent de langue, mais
so they switch language, but they do not change themselves. So the most important thing, truly, is
la capacité qu'a l'écrivain
the writer's ability
à ressentir, à s'inspirer.
To feel, to be inspired by the wealth of all the languages.
Alors, le peuple Batuto,
the Batuto people was invented by Glissant.
C'est un peuple qui est invisible.
It's an invisible people.
Et qui, dès le départ,
and from the very start,
au lieu de rentrer dans les absolus
instead of being located within the territorial, linguistic, religious and symbolic absolute, this people from the get-go
a existé sur la totalité du monde.
Existed within the totality of the world.
Dès le départ, ils se sont dispersés.
And from the beginning, they dispersed to live within in the world in its totality.
D'une certaine manière, ce peuple
in a certain sense,
a déjà réalisé
already
ce que nous devons réaliser nous aujourd'hui.
Did what we are still to do.
Et que Studio Creole essaye
de Studio Creole is trying to do this now.
Thank you so much, Patrick. A big round of applause for Patrick and Claudia. Thank you so much. And for those of you who haven't read Sartorius, it's a very amazing novel. It's a very urgent novel for that current moment in the world where we have often lack of solidarity, rise of nationalism, because it is very much a novel about mondialité. It's about what Glissant calls la mondialité, and that of course brings us right away to Alejandro. And it was interesting when we spoke with Adam actually about this project. In the very first meeting 3 years ago, Adam said it's urgent we invite Alejandro. And so we are so delighted that Alejandro is here. And of course, this whole idea of Weltliteratur, the idea that we go beyond the national literature, already Goethe said that, you know, national literature is an unmeaning term, and that was centuries ago, as Adam says in his introduction, and we're living in this world of world literature. Now, I wanted to ask you to tell us a little bit what that idea of world literature, what this idea also of Studio Creole means to you.
Well, thank you for having me. I'm really glad to be here. And I would like to thank especially to Adam because, well, he's not the usual English language writer, you know, like English language writers are always asking you, when are you going to start writing in English? And this is exactly what Adam does not want us to do, you know, and I really admire the way he approaches world literature and tries to understand what is really about, what are we dealing with, and you know, it's really easy to get to patronizing points of view. I mean, and not only here and everywhere. You know, I speak Spanish, which is basically a language that almost destroyed indigenous languages in the territory I live in. So it's not something simple. And I love the way it flows, the project, because of that, because interpreters are here. She's amazing. It is really hard to do that job, you know, really like, but it's really hard, you know, and I've been working with Ricardo and he's amazing too. And it's a different job than literary translator. It's totally different. It's kind of the opposite. So it's really good to show that, you know. Her name is there, you know. Her name is in the program. And this is not the usual thing. So I think that is great. And I was remembering too when I lived in New York for a while. I was there for a year. So my books were obviously read in English, and I have this wonderful translator, which is also now one of my biggest friends, Megan McDowell. So she was my voice in English, and people who I got to know, they read my books in English. And when I was halfway through my residency there, I started getting invitations for reading my work in English, which is basically, as you can hear, a language I do not speak. but they wanted me to read translations, so I at first I said, like, I can't. But then I thought, well, I'm going to imitate her, you know? And I started reading my book, but it was her book, and then I was with the WhatsApp asking Megan to read aloud my writing in order to imitate the way she was making it alive, and it was very funny because I was really imitating her, you know, and so it's so good to have that on. Under the spotlight, you know? So I don't know, I don't remember your question. Okay, I'm talking about the creolization. I think this is great, and I think all writing is about belonging, you know? Every book ever written is about that. You can say, what do you write about? Oh, I write about love, I write about death, I write about my country, but you also can say that you write about belonging or not wanting to belong, you know, belonging to a couple, belonging to a country, belonging to the Boy Scout group or the hooligans or whatever, or a rock band. And so there is always that tension between the personal and the collective, and there is always that tension between the national and the international. So it's really important the moment where you understand that the national thing, it is also international, You know that you lose confidence in the way you conceive language. Maybe people would think that writers are people very secure of language. But my impression is that writers are always asking themselves about language, and they really want to recover, as I don't know, Baudelaire would say, to recover the way you learn how to speak. You learn to speak over and over, and that's a pleasure. That is the playful part of it. So I don't really know what you were asking me, but this is my answer.
Well, it's been a great answer. And I mean, one of the things which is of course important, you pointed out, is you know, this visibility of the interpreters, also what we discussed with Adam, that there is no hierarchy, you know, in the project, and that it has a lot to do with talking and listening. And that is something which is deeply rooted in your literature, your books. The moment I started to read your books, I always felt there is a very strong presence of orality. Can you talk a little bit about the importance, or as you said in an interview actually recently, the desire to be talking and to be listening?
Yeah, I think that is all I consciously do when I write. I mean, but I wouldn't say consciously. I mean, when you write, and I have heard this from many other writers, you just want to get to the point where you are not thinking anymore. You are there, and you get to an intensity, and although you are doing something that is slightly related to your plan, you are losing control. You don't know how this flows that way, how, you know, there is something that you are missing, and that is really important, to have the sensation that you are there in a deeper way. How can I put this? You want to forget your plan. I know there are other kind of writers, I mean, that are just following a pattern. But I really like the idea of improvising. In the way jazz musicians are improvising, it's not that they cannot play the instrument. They know how to play it. But there is something going on when you write that you forget. You didn't know you had all those voices inside. And you didn't know you had that images. And that always, that only happens when you forget that you're writing. I mean, reading is similar, you know? What do you want from a book? You want to forget you're reading the book. You just want to be there, amazed, and not to be thinking, oh, look at this metaphor. Well, you don't want that. You don't want to stop and say, wow, that this guy knows how to write. No, you think of it afterwards, like, but in the moment, if you get distracted, you close the book. This is a natural thing. Like you forget your. I remember that. I don't know if it's really related, but I was in Colombia like 10 years ago, and in front of an audience of students, very 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 young people, like 10 years old, and there was this little boy that raised his hand and asked me and two other writers. He was like 8 years old, a very young boy. He asks us, like, I know you always talk about the inspiration, but you talk about the inspiration to writing, and I want to know where could I get the inspiration for reading, you know? So, but reading is really boring to me, he said. You know? So I want to get the inspiration to read. But it was a point, you know, because it's really hard to understand why people like reading, you know. But I think one good explanation is that it is something you start doing and that can make you forget that you're doing it. It's beautiful. And at the same time, reading is a way of learning to be alone and not suffering. And nobody wants to be alone nowadays, but if you are there with a book, you learn how to deal with yourself, I think.
I love that idea of the inspiration.
Sorry, in English, I really sound like a self-help writer, but it's fine.
No, I it's wonderful, and the idea of the inspiration, you know, of reading, it was actually many conversations we had in the lead-up to the project had to do with that. I had a great conversation with Lisa Dwan, who's going to be on the next panel, you know, with Adam about that, and a few days later, Salman Rushdie came to my office. We again spoke about it. The inspiration of reading, the inspiration of writing, and that leads me to my last question to you, which is about the story you wrote for Studio Creole, because I would like us to move now from Edouard Glissant and from Sartorius, from Batutu, quoted by Patrick, to Emily Dickinson, because your story connects to that. I wanted to ask you why and how it connects to Emily Dickinson, and if you can just tell us about the amazing story you wrote for.
I think it's related to the way I started studying English, because I never studied English, as you can hear. No? I didn't study. I mean, I just got it because we are exposed to English and music and films and all that stuff. So my English was really weird in the beginning, because I did like, I don't know, music and films, but I also was reading poetry in English, but in these bilingual editions. So it was the poem there and the translation. But a sad thing about books in Chile is that most of them are coming from Spain, and they speak a very different Spanish than us. So it's not that we really like it. We kind of hate not the Spanish of Spain, but the fact that we are reading that language that we feel very far away from us. So there was the translation there, and we didn't like it, and at the same time, the original text. So we started translating it immediately. Without even realizing that we were translating it, you know, like this would sound better this way. But we didn't know English. We were translating Emily Dickinson, which is really hard to read in English. I mean, for a native, Emily Dickinson is really hard to read. But we were reading her through the Spanish translation, through a different version of that translation. So that made my English really weird, because it was like mixing, I don't know, Seinfeld and Emily Dickinson, or Nirvana and Emily Dickinson, you know? That's like the first time I was in New York, I was very nervous, because I was supposed to speak in front of an audience for the first time in English. And my publisher came across and asked me, "Are you nervous?" And I said, and I really liked the guy, so I didn't want to say, "Yes, I'm nervous." I wanted to say something more sophisticated. So I said to him, "I feel like a quicker blood, you know?" I was thinking in an Emily Dickinson poem. I never hear the word escape without a quicker blood, which is a very beautiful poem. So that came to my mind. So I felt a quick, I feel a quicker blood. So my publisher was like, let's go to a clinic. Let's cancel this thing, you know? This guy is about to die. And I was just trying to find a way of saying that I was nervous and I was excited. And so that kind of mistakes, I was making them the whole time, you know? Like using, at the same time, when you speak another language, you always have the feeling that you are imitating someone. So and the story is about a little about that, you know. You feel like, I don't know, you heard that in a movie. It takes a long time for you to have your favorite words or to have an idea of what kind of English do you speak. And it's really complicated. And at the same time, you start imitating the accent. It's really interesting that sometimes you get to understand better with people who are non-native because you speak the same bad English, you know? And it's harder to understand and to be understood by a native. But I don't know, Japanese, Chinese, it is it's so beautiful to communicate, you know, to just communicate. And okay, I have to finish this.
I mean, there could not be a more wonderful conclusion, and I think we went, you know, from writing to reading in this conversation, but also you've both through your texts showed us that language is the door to a whole world. And I wanted to end here with a quote from Etel Adnan, who recently told me something which I think really deeply relates to Studio Creole. Etel said, thankfully, we are living after Babel, in a world of many languages that we can all move between. Our deepest identity is created from an infinite number of things, and every language is the door to a whole world. And with these words of Etel, I would like to thank so much Claudia Bragman, Patrick Chamazo, Alejandro Zambra, and you all for being here. Thank you very much. Muchas gracias. Merci beaucoup.